For so long I carried the weight of my past, crippled by burdens like stones on my back. I thought I had fallen too far from your grace.
Welcome to Recovery Radio, where we have hope for you today.
When I was lost, so searching, you were the ground beneath my feet. When I was a blind man begging, you were the eye so I could see.
Good morning, Recovery Radio. This is your host, Sean. How's everyone doing this morning? I hope everyone is having a blessed morning this morning. I want to introduce my co-host, Val. She's here. She's going to be helping me out today because this is my first time hosting. And, of course, we have our engineer, Bill.
Who, yes, sir.
Is here all the time. I don't know when he has time to do anything else because he's always here with us. So, Val, why don't you open us up in prayer this morning?
I'd love to. Thank you for asking. Father God, I thank you for your mercy and your grace. I just ask that you're with the listeners today and with us here in this room. Just remind us how much you love us. Thank you for all of your sacrifices for dying for us so that our sin could be forgiven and we could be freed from that. And in Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen.
Amen. So, we have quite a few sponsors. Bill, could you read those sponsors off to us?
Sure. We'd love to thank you. Easy Rider Motorcycle Testing, now hiring riders. They're located at 1080 Aviation Drive. You can also get a hold of them by the phone at 928-706-4553. Havasu Kindness, Lake Havasu Souvenirs and Christian Decor, hats, t-shirts, and more. Located at 2018 McCulloch Boulevard North in Lake Havasu. You can get a hold of them by the phone at 928-505-0451. Remember, kindness spreads joy. And we have Lynn's Little China, Christian-owned and operated restaurant for over 20 years, serving New York-style Chinese food 7 days a week, located here in Lake Havasu City at 1632 McCulloch Boulevard in Lake Havasu, in Kingman at 4120 Stockton Hill Road. And Hilltop Community Church, we thank you for your support of Recovery Radio with shirts and hats. And they're located at 3180 McCulloch Boulevard North or on the web at hilltoplhc.com. And anonymous sponsor, God knows who you are, and we thank you for your support.
God does know who you are.
Yes.
We have so many great sponsors, and we are so thankful for all our sponsors. We just ask you just continue to help us out as we just try to reach the world. So, this is a call-in show. We encourage you guys to call in, and if you give us a great call, we will give you a hat and a t-shirt. You'll be eligible to be able to get that, and it would be awesome and great.
Yeah, they get entered into a drawing, and at the end of the show, we'll name that person, and our producer, Pat, will get a hold of you.
Right. So, Recovery Radio is here to help us with life struggles in our sinful nature and our effects for our lives and the lives of others. Boy, we all are just a bunch of sinners, aren't we? So, Val, you want to read our scripture for the day?
Sure. Scripture for today is Galatians 5:1. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. And I just wanted to, if we could go back to what our show is all about and what it's not about. So Sean explained what we are about to help each other with our struggles.
Amen.
Yeah. And then what we're not about, as we are here to support one another, but we cannot fix anyone. Only Jesus Christ has that kind of power. He can change your life. And we know this by reading God's holy word, which states to share each other's burdens, lift each other up, encourage one another, pray for each other so we can be healed.
You know, I don't know about you guys, but I can't do it without Jesus each and every day.
That's right.
Amen.
You know, first thing in the morning when I get up, I read my devotional, I have my coffee, and I sit there and just listen to my worship music and just try to get into the word and just get into Jesus and just lean back into him. Every day, for me, it's Proverbs 3:5, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your understanding. So that's where I'm at on a daily basis. So our topic today is freedom from what you are carrying or holding on to that has you captured. For me, there is a lot there. There's a lot that used to keep me captured. There's a lot that Jesus has taken, and I'm sure that there's still a lot of things that people still struggle with. I know I have struggles daily. I have struggles and issues all the time. And without Jesus, man, I would be a sinking ship.
That's right. So can we go ahead and give the listeners the phone number that they can reach us at, Sean?
Yes. Our phone number is 800-721-9313. And our local number is 928-855-9110. Please call in. Give us your opinion about what you think about this topic.
Yeah. So the topic is about freedom. And so I just wanted to start the conversation by asking a question of you two gentlemen and then everyone listening, if you want to call in and share what you feel. So for me, I think about freedom and the differences in my life from many years ago till now. So over 3 years ago, I completely surrendered my life to Jesus. I was addicted to drugs. I was facing prosecution. I was facing possibly losing my family. You know, so that was the end of the road where I had to ask myself, how did I get to that place? How did I become only dependent on myself? And I realized that I was powerless. God was all powerful. And I recognized that I had so much shame. I didn't feel confident in the presence of God, even to worship him or go to him for anything. Mm-hmm. So that's what I would like to ask you, Sean. So what is it that gives you confidence to be in the presence of God versus what it looked like years ago for you?
I still struggle with confidence in the presence of God. If it wasn't for him getting a hold of me 3 years ago, I would probably still be running amok. I don't know what happened that specific day. I don't know how it is that I actually surrendered, but I just remember God coming into the picture and me just being filled with the Holy Spirit for the first time, which was a new experience for me, which was completely odd and weird. But for the first year, it was about me letting go and God just loving on me and me just being able to receive his love. Because for me, I couldn't receive love. I had no idea. I still struggle with love. Sure. I still ask him to fill me with his love because my love, you know, I have no idea what my love was about. But his love is what's important. And his love is just so awesome and is so great. And he allows me, I'm so grateful that he allows me into his presence to where I can sit there and I can worship him, that right. I can learn more about right. him, that I can just all these things with him because he's taken so much away and he continues to work on me just gently and lovingly. And I mean, it's just, it's so awesome and it's just so great. What about you? I mean, for you, I mean, we pray together and I feel the Spirit come from you also, just how awesome the Spirit is and how, and what it does for us.
Right. Cause when we receive that, you know, and the Word tells us we have that Holy Spirit that will intervene for us. Even when we don't have the words, we just have groaning. He can reach through to us and guide us and take us to the next step, even if when we don't have confidence in ourselves. And that's what I think is really important for people that are still struggling with, you know, feeling completely free or held captive to some type of stronghold or some type of issue in their life, whether that's pornography addiction, you know, codependency, whatever it is that's keeping you at a distance from having that close, intimate, personal relationship with Jesus Christ, to find complete freedom from having those barriers between you and God. I think, you know, it's not just a physical experience, but, you know, it's a healing of the mind. It's a healing of the way we look outside of ourselves at other people in the world. For me, it's easier to see other people who are hurting because I recognize myself in that.
Right.
And you can, you know, would you agree with that?
I totally agree with that. Mm-hmm. I totally agree. So all the issues that I struggled with and the issues that I still struggle with, even being at Celebrate Recovery, at being at church, at just my day to day, even the guys that I work with, I see so much of me in them and I want so much to just have them to be able to experience the freedom that I have.
Yeah.
That's my biggest thing is to, for the hurt and the lost anybody that doesn't know Christ, even the people that do know Christ, to be able to experience the freedom that I have, because it's just, it's pure freedom.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I just, and I'm in love with it. And I can't, it's almost, I can't get enough of it.
Yes.
Right? I mean, it's just so awesome. And it's just so great. Go ahead.
So, yeah, I just, you know, I was just thinking about that before we started the show. Like, what was the barrier? And I would love to hear from the listeners what your barrier was or is and what it looks like for you. You know, we want to talk about the breakthroughs, not only that maybe you have experienced, but the breakthroughs that you're praying for. If you're still stuck in that, you know, that just being bound and chained from being completely free, we would love to talk to you about that. Or if you've found a way out of that and you're walking in freedom from your sin, we would also love for you to call in and talk to us about that. The number is 1-800-721-9313 or locally 928-855-9110.
Yeah, that would be great. We'd love to have some callers.
Yes.
So one of the things that I've been working on has been anxiety. Anxiety, and it stems from my self-esteem. My self-esteem has been horrible since I was a kid. I'm starting to learn all this. God's finally starting to open up all this to me. And so the more that I dig into it and the more that I look back at it, this has been there since I was young. And I really don't know why yet, but the self-esteem issue has caused me to have this anxiety, to just not want to be out in public. It captures me and it takes me and it just wants me to stay inside, to not go outside. I don't want you to, you know, I don't want to go outside. I don't want to talk to people. I don't want to go to church and greet people. It's kind of funny when that happens. And then now here I am serving three services and greeting people all the time and being part of the prayer team and wanting to reach out to people. But I really don't want to do it. The anxiety was so crippling for me that it would just be horrible. I would be going to work. I'd be driving to work and just breaking down going, what is going on? Why? What is it? And I feel it's just the enemy just trying to hold on to me and just try to drag me back into what I was in. You know, because I still have the thoughts, you know, well, maybe if you pick up a can of chew, it'll, you know, you'll be okay. It'll help with the anxiety. Or you go home and drink a couple beers. It'll be okay because it'll help with the anxiety. But I don't want to do that. I don't want to go back into that bondage of all that. And so I struggle. Yeah. I struggle with it all the time.
Yeah.
But God allows me to lean back into Him. And when I stop my nonsense, when I stop letting it run in my head, because once it gets going, it's hard to get rid of it. I go, okay, Lord, I take a deep breath. I say my prayer and I lean back into Him and I just allow Him to do the work. Because that's what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to let go of the wheel and allow Him to move us forward.
That's right. Absolutely. I love that you talked about, you know, you, even though you have surrendered and it's a completely different, He transforms our minds where He uses what used to hold us back. Like you said, you used to want to stay in your house, not greet people. That is the enemy trying to find that, like, hey, he's an introvert, so I'm going to use this against him. Whereas God uses those weaknesses for Him. So, you know, you have that desire to want to meet people where they're at. And, you know, when people are walking in the church and that your prayers are just so spirit-led. And it's incredible the change that I've seen, what God has done, how you talked about how you used to be versus what I see now is like a 180, and God does that, right?
Yes.
He takes us and He makes us brand new.
Thank you for that too.
Yeah. So I'd like to ask the listeners to ask, I'm going to ask them to join me in a test. So the devil knows our name, yet he calls us by our sin. Like you were talking about, Sean, your anxiety. He calls you by that and he uses that. So while God knows our sin, yet calls us by our name. So let me ask the listeners, are you hearing your name being as worthless, loser, burden, unlovable, unredeemable, or are you hearing chosen, a vessel of the Holy Spirit, image bearer, my precious child? What are you hearing from God? And that can be a good indicator about, okay, so I'm hearing these negative things and these negative voices. So I need to take that thought captive. I need to go to the Word and see what Jesus Christ says, who I am. And you are loved. You are redeemable. Mm-hmm. You are an image bearer of Christ. That is, to me, that was so mind-blowing when I really understood what those words meant and I received it for myself. Once the shame was let go, once I was able to let go of some of the shame, you know, God was able to reach through and penetrate my heart because it was totally walled up. I was hiding. I was running. I was in the darkness. And once my sin got exposed to the light, that's when Jesus came in and was able to do the good work that he wanted to do in my life the whole time. But I had to be open to receive that. Right. Yes.
Yeah, that's part of the whole surrender thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If we're not surrendered to it and we're not allowing him, because we can keep him from doing all that. I was in a men's home when I first got saved, and I would see guys that would say they were surrendered but just wouldn't allow God into certain parts of our lives. And we do that. We put up this wall, or we allow our heart to become like granite. And I used to tell the guys at night, because we had 14 guys in this barrack, kind of like a barrack situation. And I would sleep down on the end, and I'd hear everyone snoring at night, and I wouldn't sleep, and I'd always be going through my head with the Lord and scripture and everything else, and I'd hear a little dink, dink, and I'm like, Lord, what is that? And he's like, I'm working on your heart. Mm. You know, I have to take a jackhammer to that granite, you know, because it's so hard, but I'm going to give you a heart of flesh. But it's going to take time. It doesn't happen overnight. I'm like, why not? You know, you took my addiction of meth and alcohol away right off the bat. Why can't you just take everything else? You know, why can't we just make this happen overnight?
Because a masterpiece comes to light one hammer stroke at a time, Sean.
Exactly. Mm. That's what he's been teaching me lately.
Yeah.
Is to be...
Michelangelo didn't create, you know, his art's work with just one brush stroke.
No. Mm. It takes
time.
Over time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm learning that. And I'm not patient by any means. You know what I'm saying? I think we all struggle with patience.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, that's much so.
That's why I know James chapter 1, verses 2, 3, and 4. Trust me. Counting all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing the testing of your faith produces patience. And let patience have its perfect work, so you may be perfect, complete, lacking nothing. Can we just hurry up and just be complete now? Can we just have those new bodies, you know?
Yeah.
You know, that's really interesting you bring that up, because I think that's another important thing for me in my journey as God's molding me and teaching me new things. It's like, I want to jump to the next thing before this first thing he's working on me is done. So like you said, I'm impatient with that. So he's like, nope, not until you learn this lesson. And then I recognize it's not a me wanting to get it done. Once he has worked that out in my life, like for instance, my shame associated with sexual sin that was visited upon me as a child, once I was able to, you know, work through that in therapy and with God, I was able to release that and offer forgiveness, true forgiveness for not only the people, but for myself. That was way harder because I had so much shame, and the devil is extremely adept at using sexual sin, whether that's something that we're going out and doing or whether that's we're victims of. He is so adept at going, you know what, I'm going to use this. And shame to me for in my life has kept me, and I've seen it in a lot of women that I you know, am in this recovery with. That is a huge barricade from total freedom.
It is for men too. Mm-hmm. I'm going to tell you, I struggle with that. That was one of my biggest things, was the sexual sin and the thoughts and the actions that took place and all the things. And the devil uses it and he throws it into my mind. And then I'm thinking about it. And next thing you know, I'm all the way in left field going, what the heck? What? How did I just get here? Mm-hmm. Oh, it was because of that, because I allowed that thought to come into my mind. And when it came into my mind, instead of getting rid of it real fast, I started to dwell on it and I started to think about it. And it can cause me to go into more sin, which I am very careful of. I try very hard to be very careful of. For men, pornography, at least from my standpoint and what I've experienced from other men, is we're visual.
Mm-hmm. Very.
And we tend to go towards the visual. Why? Because it makes us feel good. Mm-hmm. So we struggle with that. I pray for a lot of brothers that we struggle with that. And we continue on a daily basis. For me, I have to give it to God on a daily basis. I could be driving along doing my job. And next thing I know, it's there. And I'm like, no, Lord, this isn't what I want anymore.
Yeah.
I want what you want. And I pray at that point, let me hate the things that you hate, because I don't want that in my life anymore. I don't need this in my life anymore. I don't need to feel complete. And that went with my codependency too. Mm-hmm. That was just, it was a wreck for me, and it caused a lot of shame for me.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, I want to once more reach out to the listener. If you're hearing something that you're relating to, or you want to call in and let us know what your breakthrough from and what you're walking in freedom from, or what you'd like prayer over, our number is 1-800-721-9313. You don't have to come on the air. Just give us a call, and or you could go to our website, RecoveryRadioLHC.com, and you can connect with us there. But I wanted to also mention, Sean, it's true that I believe probably pornography is more prevalent in men, but the ladies are catching up, unfortunately, with that issue. Mm-hmm. It's not something that's talked about as much with women, but I believe it's much more prevalent than what's just statistics show,
which is 30%.
Right.
That's high.
Right.
That's really high.
I didn't know it was that high.
Yeah. In women. Yeah.
And I believe it's
men,
higher.
It's over 50.
So, men, I knew that it was that high, but I didn't know it was like that for women.
Yeah. And it's even prevalent in the church.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's big in the church. I know that. Yeah. I just heard numbers not too long ago that I went, wow. Just unbelievable. And people that are on staff and stuff too. It's a struggle. It's a huge struggle.
It is.
It is a big struggle. My last relationship, she was into it. And so it just helped me ride along and then just blossomed and grew into this big old thing. And like I said, it's been a struggle for me to get over all that.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about for a minute, Bill, why is it so prevalent in the church?
Ooh. Because we're still human.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that some men, even in the church, they carried it with them.
Mm-hmm.
It's something that they tried to leave at the altar. You know, it's one of those things that we pick back up again. And it's because the way that we are created, men desire women.
Mm-hmm.
That's, you know, our goal is to find a mate and, you know, produce children. And that's hardwired into us because God created us that way. But he created women to be that vessel that we're supposed to, you know, love and cherish and build that life with and have that intimacy with.
Mm-hmm.
And Satan loves to destroy that image.
That guy sucks.
And he will do everything he can in his power to make sure that when a man and woman get together, that they don't wait until the marriage.
Mm-hmm.
They don't wait until those vows are said. They don't wait until the rings are put on and they walk down the aisle as a couple. And it is so, even in the church, it is so, you know, we're just going to live together just to see if we work, you know, kind of attitude. Well, that's dumb. All you're doing is opening the door for that next step. You know, why would you do that?
Mm.
Well, it's because our society today has walked away from the Word of God, even in the church.
Mm-hmm. I think I'll be as bold to say the church does a terrible job as a whole about bringing these things to light. I think if the leaders are living transparently, the people who are coming there and they're looking up at these people as, you know, they're guiding them spiritually. Mm-hmm. So they're going to really respond to a leader who says, you know what, I struggle with A, B, and C. And if one of those things happens to be sexual sin, well, that builds trust between the congregation and the people who are leading spiritually. And I think that the church as a whole probably does a lackluster job in bringing these things out into the light. Because if we do, that's where it gets to die. That's where God gets to do his work, like I referred to earlier.
And it's really hard to talk about.
It is, because there's shame attached.
Yes, that is the big one right there, shame. Mm-hmm. The shame that is attached with, you know, the stigma of, you know, the pornography industry and the church as a whole. You know, it's not supposed to be there.
Right.
Not supposed to have that in the church.
Mm-hmm.
But unfortunately, we do.
Right.
And it's because we're human and people make mistakes and we get entangled into it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's been a struggle for me for since I was 7 years old.
Yeah,
I was shown my first pornography movie at seven.
Wow.
Grew up with Playboys in the basement. My dad was a subscriber. He had every issue, you know, so we would, me and my friends would go through them, you know. And so it was always there. Mm-hmm. Nudity was something that was just there. I had relatives that were more than willing to, you know, do things.
Mm-hmm.
So it was very tough growing up.
Yeah.
You know, I was the oldest of six children, or I should say I am the oldest, not was, I am. And so, you know, I have uncles that are 3 and 7 years older than me, you know, and they were like my big brothers, you know, growing up. Mm-hmm. So everything they did, I did, you know, kind of thing. And vodka and orange juice was something that they liked to drink. So at seven, I had my first cigar, my first alcoholic drink, and I watched a stag film at seven.
Wow.
And it just grew from there.
Yeah.
Next came chewing tobacco at eight, smoking cigarettes by nine, you know, just drinking, you know, when all of that stuff was going on. And my parents had no clue, none whatsoever, what we were doing. And then came more of the pornography and playing strip poker with my babysitter, who was the girlfriend of my one uncle. Mm. You know, just think, I mean, it was a hard time,
yeah,
you know, as a kid. And then when my mom passed away at 12 years old, I was lost, you know. I blamed God. I was mad. Mm. I had guilt because the day that she died, I was sick a couple of days before, and I didn't want to go to school. I was a very selfish and a bully to my siblings. That day, I remember saying to her, now, I've never said this before on the air, so this is kind of huge for me. I wish you were dead. I told her that the day she died. I remember sitting in my bed. She said, you don't have a fever. You're going to have to go to school. And I was mad. I mean, I was really, really mad. I didn't want to go to school. And later that day, they came and got us from school, and my Uncle Chuck and drove us to their house. And my birthday was 2 days later. So I thought they were just, you know, having some kind of party for us. We all were there, my grandma and grandpa, all my uncles and aunts. I was like, wow, you know, this is going to be great. It's going to be awesome. Mm. Get in there, and they sit us down on the living room floor and tell us that there's been an accident. My brother Sean and my dad are in the hospital. He was Sean's my baby brother. And he was like 3 years old when it happened. She moved to protect him from the dump truck, hit him. They T-boned her, my dad's car, and she took the full force of the truck hitting the passenger door. She pretty much died instantly, holding my baby brother. And then she was ejected from the car. They hit some black ice and spun out and went into the ditch. My dad was in the hospital for a couple of weeks with a steering wheel size bruise on his chest, concussion from hitting the windshield because he tried to grab her. So when they impacted the ditch, he went into the windshield. My brother and her went out of the vehicle. He had just a few cuts from the glass. That's all was wrong with him. So they kept him for observation, you know, just in case he had hit his head or anything. My dad couldn't even attend the funeral because he was in that bad of shape in the hospital. So from that point, I went deep into the dark side, mm-hmm, you could say.
Mm-hmm.
And things really changed for me. You know, because I was not only mad at God, but I was mad at myself for what I said. And to this day, I cannot remember anything after that, that morning, except being at school with my, when my uncle came and got me. I can't remember going to school. I can't remember, you know, if we, you know, talked, if I said I was sorry. I can't remember any of it to this day.
Wow.
And it's been 40 years, 41 actually. So that was the tipping point for me. And then it got really bad, you know, after that. By 15, I was no longer a virgin. And so I had already experienced, you know, that intimacy with a woman before getting married, you know, everything. And by the time I was 17 and a half, God got a hold of me. He took the shotgun out of my hand and put it in the closet. I was ready to blow my head away, you know, blow it off. And because of all the stuff that I had done, you know, before that, I was just depressed big time. I mean, I was in a black place. And so when I moved on from that, you know, going to an altar and being set free, that huge, huge weight, a ton of bricks coming off my not only my chest, but my shoulders. Praise God. I felt that, I felt like I could float.
Yeah.
I mean, it was incredible.
Yeah.
Then getting baptized and coming up out of the water and just having a peace that just, like his word says, it surpasses all understanding, you know, and that new life. I've got goosebumps.
Goosebumps.
It was so incredible, guys. I mean, that whole experience, my childhood and all that I went through, molestation to molesting others, to, you know, all of that stuff, the pornography, the alcohol, the drugs, all of it was gone. And just for the first time in my whole life, I just felt so much love. I mean, it was incredible.
Yeah. It was gone in the sense of you didn't feel that heaviness and shame.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was completely gone.
Wow. I want to, first of all, thank you for being, you're always so transparent and open, and you do these like on-air admissions that I'm just like, woo, okay, that's how you celebrate recovery over there. But thank you so much for sharing that for the first time. That's huge,
yes,
Bill.
Thank you, Bill.
That's huge.
That's really, really huge.
And I'm sure that there's listeners out there that it really impacted, and that's exactly what God needed them to hear in order for them to finally say, you know what, I surrender.
Yeah, there's hope.
There is.
Trust me.
There is.
You know, Sean, when you were talking earlier about your anxiety and not wanting to move or talk to anybody, or, you know, and all of these images in the Old Testament come just flooding into my mind, like Moses and Gideon and David, and you know, and you think about what we hold back, you know, or what our fears are, if I could say it that way, God uses for strengths.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because when you think of Moses, he stuttered, he killed an Egyptian, you know, and he was for 40 years tending sheep on the backside of a mountain. Okay. When God got a hold of him, he didn't lead the Israelites out of the desert the next day.
No.
He didn't lead them out of captivity the next day.
No.
It took time.
Yes.
It takes time for God to make and build that masterpiece.
Oh, yeah.
He doesn't do it overnight. And you want to know why?
You're going to tell me.
Well, I know I'm going to tell
you.
He's going to tell
everyone. I want to hear it.
Because
really hear it.
The experiences that we have with him make us who we're going to be.
Yes.
And if it happens instantly, we have no foundation to stand on.
Correct. That's correct.
We have nothing in the past that we could look back on, where God brought us from. That's why I wholeheartedly believe that not only is he building you into what you're going to be, but he's taking you through it so you realize later, oh, that's why I had to go through that.
Not just that. my first year of being sober and walking with him, he took me back through my life and showed me every aspect where he was there.
Yeah.
And where we had conversations. I was like, oh, that was you. And he's like, yes, that was me.
Yeah.
You know, because before I went into my 12 years of drugs and alcohol, hardcore drugs and alcohol, he was like, this isn't the life I want for you. And I remember telling him, I don't care. It feels good.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And moving,
well, our flesh
and,
does
and,
like
and,
it.
And moving in with a woman that was married and did drugs and just it just blew, and you know, eight felonies, 16 times in jail. But you know, the thing is, he keeps telling me in this year time, I'm going to use all this.
Yeah.
You went through this. I was there with you. Regardless of you knowing or not, I was there with you. And I'm going to use every bit of it. So, yeah. And I see him in the last 3 years, especially in the last 6 months that I moved here, him working on that and him showing that to me, him revealing that to me, falling into obedience. When you finally get into obedience, that whole thing, he opens up so many more doors for you to be able to let go of stuff, but not only that, for him to be able to work on you and for him to reveal stuff to you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Is that how it was for you guys? I mean, because that's really how it was for me. It was just him revealing, him showing, and him working, and him doing it out of gentleness. Now, don't get me wrong. It's painful. There are times that there's stuff that I don't want to let go of, or I don't know how to let go of.
Mm.
Right? I struggle with the whole letting go thing. I haven't gotten that concept completely, totally, that it's okay to let go of it. It's okay to cry. Yeah. It's okay to get on your knees and fall on your face and go, okay, God, I can't do this anymore. I can't hold on to this anymore. Take it from me. Now, there's other things too that I take to the altar. I lay it at the cross, kind of like pornography, and I pick it back up and I carry it around. So there's many different avenues of it. But I'm grateful for it. And you're right. It does take time. It's a time thing. And I'm not patient.
I know. I know. Me neither.
I don't think we are.
You know, the older I get, the more patient I am with certain things. But when it comes to wanting, you know, something right now.
Yeah.
You know, and being in the kind of generation that we are now where you can, you know, go through a drive-thru and have your meal in 3 minutes. Put it in the microwave, you know, all of that. I mean, instant online, you know, you can get facts from Alexa at home. You can, you know, hey, Siri, you know, you can do all kinds of this stuff and have it right now.
Mm-hmm.
Our God is not a right now.
No, he's not.
But he's not also a hurry up and wait either, because he will walk us through it. And it does take time, because
Don't get me wrong, that there's things he's told me he wants me to do.
Well, yeah, there is.
And I'm like, no, I don't want to do that.
Well, you can tell him that.
And he just, that's the whole thing. And then all of a sudden I feel this nudge.
Yeah.
Or all of a sudden I fall into it. Like, Mike, how do you feel about being on the radio? No. Well,
yeah.
God said, I said, I know. He told me a couple months ago already, and now he's having you tell me no.
Yeah.
But here I am, you know, that's the obedient part.
Yeah. Well, Moses said the same thing.
Well, yeah.
So did David.
And let's look at
Paul. So did Gideon.
Let's look at Paul.
So did Paul.
Right?
You know.
Paul was out.
Yeah, you can go through a lot of the Old Testament and look back on, you know, how long it took for them to actually get it. The Israelites roamed in the desert for 40 years, man. Do we want to spend 40 years waiting for us to get our acting gear? I don't want to do that.
Right? That's it for me too, because I want it right now.
But there are examples in the Word where things happened right now.
Oh yeah.
Lots of them.
Yes.
With Jesus miracles, healings, you know, all kinds of stuff. But there's so many that take time too.
Yeah.
420 years for their freedom. Just in one instance. So we've got to, you know, kind of take it and put it and balance it in the scales for our freedoms that we have in him today. We got to make sure that we're listening to the right voices, like Val was saying earlier. You know, what are you being called? what name is being called to you. Exactly. Are you, you know, like, I think it's, is it Big Daddy Weeb that in the Redeemed song, you know, says that they were worthless, you know, and, you know, all of these voices were being spoken to them. And then what are we being called? Are we called chosen? Are we called my child? Are we called, you know, and we've got to make sure that we're listening.
So for me and my self-esteem issues and also the anxiety, I struggle with that.
Mm-hmm.
I struggle with you are forgiven. You're a child of God.
I think we all do in some way.
You're abundant, not just loved, but you're abundantly loved.
Yeah.
I want more for you. I'm going to give you more. And I'm like, are you kidding me? You know who you're talking to, Lord? And I have this conversation with him all the time. Do you know who you're talking to? Do you remember who that guy is? You know, you don't. And I pulled the whole Moses thing. Me, come on. I can't talk. I'm going to stutter. I can name a million reasons why you don't want me. And then he goes, yeah. Well, you don't want to look at Moses and look at Paul. And I go, oh, okay, sure. Uh-huh. So go ahead.
Oh, I just wanted to say Pat sent us over a message that there's a gentleman by the name of Steve listening, and he loves his show and thanks us for having talking about this subject. I think it's really important. I just wanted to also reach out to the listeners. This is a live call-in show. Our number is 1-800-721-9313. We would love to hear your thoughts on this issue of freedom and what may be holding you back, or what are you walking in freedom now due to what Christ has done in your life.
Exactly. We would love to hear from anybody.
Yes. And, you know, you guys were talking about obedience earlier, and I had this conversation with one of my good friends recently about it's so incredible the blessings that come into your life that God presents you with when you are not only obedient to his word and obedient what the Holy Spirit is convicting you and guiding you to do, because we have that now in us, now that we've received Christ, we receive the Holy Spirit who guides us and protects us. But when we do it in spite of ourselves, when we do exactly what we don't want to do, like you were talking about, you're not going to speak on the radio. You know, I'm the same way. When I was someone in my life who I respect deeply told me one day you're going to be really open about your story, because I was in counseling with them, and I'm like, you've lost your mind.
Right?
Mm-hmm. I am the last person who will get up and tell people about my deepest, darkest secrets. I won't even do that to myself, let alone a room full of people. But once God entered my life and released me from the shame, I recognize his sovereignty, his power, that he is going to use me as a vessel. And I was willing to do it because I wanted people to understand that there is hope. There is freedom in Christ. And this is the way that he got to me in my life, the way he broke through to me. And sharing that is exactly what we're called to do according to scripture.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're supposed to share our burdens and struggles and allow people to see the power, not of what we've done, because we haven't done anything, but say, accept God's, you know, power through us to be used to bring other people to understand that they are loved, they are forgiven, right?
Yes. So if you're a listener out there right now and you're struggling and you don't know Christ, I do encourage you today to call out to him.
Mm.
He will meet you with open arms. He will be right there, even if you've fallen back into sin. Even if you're just struggling, if you don't know him, call out to Jesus. Jesus will meet you right there. He met me right there. He met us right there.
Yes.
Yeah.
He is so willing to be a part of your life, to change your life. And believe me, if you surrender to him and you allow the Holy Spirit to come into your life, you will be changed. I can guarantee that. He will not leave you where you're at today. He will fill you full of hope, full of love, full of encouragement. He will help you through every struggle that you have. Anxiety, your self-esteem issues, the pornography issue, the lying, the cheating, the alcohol, the drugs. It doesn't matter what it is. He will meet you right there. He will help you with it. He will help you with surrendering it even. Mm-hmm. When we want to hold on to it, he will go, no. Let's let go of that. Let's go down this road, and I will show you how much better it is for you to let go of this, for you to allow me to work on this, for me to come into your house and to clean your house and just allow me to do the work.
Yeah. So he, you know, it's funny you talk about how he will actually help you surrender. So what? How I would have seen something like being investigated by a hospital for a drug diversion as a nurse, I would have seen that as a pretty terrible thing before I understood that it was God's intervention. He allowed this to happen because he loved me enough to save my life before I took it because of how bad my addiction got. He allowed these circumstances to line up because he knew exactly what I needed in order to fully surrender to him. And what I needed was huge, big time public exposure, and that's what happened. And now I look at that situation as a blessing from God and not like, this is horrific. Like some people that hear about my story are like, oh my goodness, how, like, I can't imagine like how terrible you felt in the moment. Yes, I felt terrible. Yes, it was a struggle. Yeah. But now that I've allowed him to work this all out and trust him in the process, I look back at things like that in my life and I say, thank you, Lord.
Now, that's the thing. You have to trust the process. Mm-hmm. You have to trust in him completely and fully with all your heart.
Yes.
But it's well worth it. Yes. I can guarantee that all the way around. Yeah. Anyone you talk to that has got the Lord in their hearts, they will tell you it has been well worth it.
Amen.
Painful, but it's worth it.
Amen. So the other one more thing I wanted to bring up, we had talked about sexual sin and the shame that's associated with that. I want to reach out to the people who maybe have experienced some type of abuse in their past and just know that that shame is visited upon you. That is not yours to own. I want to encourage you. One of the scriptures that helped me, Psalm 72:4, may he defend the cause of the poor of the people, give deliverance to the children of the needy, and crush the oppressor. God cares about justice, and let him, allow him to see that through. We don't need to hang on to bitterness. We don't need to hang on to unforgiveness, because all that's doing is poisoning our own hearts against what he wants to do. Release it to God. He will take care of it all, and you'll allow yourself a level of freedom that you didn't think was possible or even necessary. But when you get to experience it, you recognize like, oh, that's what you had in store for me, by letting it go, by understanding that even though I was, you know, I am not responsible or guilty, but I can let that go because God's going to take care of it for me. I don't have to manage my circumstances because he's got it all planned out.
Right. Yeah. He's got a divine plan for all of us.
Yeah.
And we have to let him. As long as we let him, we'll do great. We'll do fine. I struggle with that. I struggle with letting him. As for the pornography thing, I just got the statistics right now. It's 30 billion views per year.
Wow.
And yes, billion. And 32% of women struggle with that are into it. And it's readily available today.
Yeah, it is.
Listen, it's not just the websites where you have to like log in and it's on the dark web. We're talking about Instagram. We're talking about all of these social media platforms.
Twitter.
It's very, like, everything's very suggestive of sex. It's very, it's not even in the background. It's very right out in front, you know, the way that you come across in some of these social media, it's right at the fingertips of our children. So I want to encourage parents too. There's a lot of things out there that you can help protect them from that. Have conversations with your kids about the importance of avoiding certain social media, you know, apps.
Yeah.
That can bring that in. We can protect our children, and I'm a firm believer. I know that my children are God's, and that, you know, he's blessed me with allowing me to be in their life while they're here on earth, while I'm here on earth. But I know that he's going to protect them, but I can do my part too. You know, he can instruct me and, hey, maybe have open conversations about what they'll experience out there in the world, so they learn to lean on God and not their parents' faith in God, but develop their own personal relationship with God and understand how to go to him in those type of things.
Exactly. Yeah, that's important. I feel that's really, really important, especially in today's age, our society, the way that children are acting today, what we see on television, just the things we see on television, the things we see on the internet. You know, this world needs Jesus and needs a whole lot of Jesus.
Yeah.
So, you know, we need to encourage our children. We need to encourage our families. We need to do the best that we can to be that light, to be that salt, to the way we act, the way we talk, the way we do, just even in our day-to-day, we should be showing Jesus. That's my biggest prayer every morning is I want people to see Jesus in me.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I don't want them to see who Sean was. So I don't talk about my past a whole lot. But I want them to see what Jesus has done, you know. And that's the whole thing. Jesus has changed my life 180 degrees all the way around. And he continues to do it, and he continues to change things. So let's look to him, and let's focus on him, and do the best that we can in this society today to just be focused on Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
amen. Right. So what it looks like to, I think, for people, you can see it not only in their countenance, the way they carry themselves, but the way they talk about their past and directing people's viewpoints right back to God and what he's done in their life versus what, you know, oh, I've done this and that, and I've been able to break free from this and that. But I see a difference between people who are walking in true freedom with Christ versus, you know, people who are saying, hey, you know, I achieved this and this and this. It's still focused on that person, but they're those kind of things can actually help build up even more strongholds, pride, yes, right? And mm-hmm. some other issues that God wants to release you from that. So I like your encouragement. If we focus on the creator, the one who created us, which is Jesus Christ, then everything else kind of naturally falls into place as he created, right?
Yes.
As he intended is mm-hmm. the word that was escaping my mind for a moment there.
Yes. As he intended us before we fell.
Right.
Before the first Adam.
Right.
Yes, I just want to continue to encourage people that it's a better way. It's an honest way. God is going to do so much, you know, and we're living in times that are just unbelievable to us. I don't think we ever imagined that we were going to see things like this, to see the sin, the way we do, the way the world is becoming. I'm going to say Sodom and Gomorrah all over again, but now it's 10 times worse because we have social media, we have internet, we have just many, many ways of being able to show it now, and it's just thrown right into our face. We're being conditioned for it. So just I pray for everyone to just continue to focus on Jesus, to focus on his will in your life, and to help, you know, be strong, to put on our armor, the armor of God, to make sure that we're wearing our armor on a daily basis, because even as Christians, even as much as the Spirit fills me, I'm still susceptible to falling back into it. And I see it and I catch myself. But thank God that he's given me that ability to be able to catch myself and to be able to go, okay, forgive me, Father. I was going in the wrong direction. Help pick me back up, and let's continue to move forward, because it's all about moving forward with him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, amen.
Mm-hmm. And talking about, I was trying to find the scripture for the armor of God, Bill. Do you know that offhand? I know it's in Romans, right?
Ephesians 6, 10 through 20.
Oh, is it Ephesians 6?
Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord, and in the power of his might, put on the whole armor of God, mm-hmm. so you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. We do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of the age, against spiritual hosts of the wickedness in the heavenly places.
That's right.
Amen. That's really, really powerful right there. We do not deal with human blood. It's the spiritual realm.
Yes.
It's amen. What goes on behind the scenes that we can't see. You know, so we need to be strong in that.
Mm-hmm. So if you haven't accepted that free gift before you, just know that it's there. We're praying for you. And the people who have experienced freedom, we have about another minute. You can call us at 1-800-721-9313 or go on our website and let us know if you'd like to touch base with us there. It's recoveryradiolhc.com. So I was thinking about this whole process of walking in freedom and being free from what kept me in the darkness and chained away. I realized Christ already broke the bonds of sin in my life when he died for my sin. He lived a sinless life and overcame the temptations of the devil because he knew he could never do, we could never do this on our own power. All I had to do was accept the free gift. I did and have been walking in that freedom from heavy oppression since that. I was, you know, in a car one day after all this news broke about everything being exposed in my life. And I was contemplating, I wasn't contemplating suicide, but I think the devil was getting in my mind, like, how can I disappear? So I went from wanting to disappear to speaking to however many people are listening right now on the radio. That's what God can do in your life if you surrender to him.
Right. Just surrender. He will. He can do amazing things, you guys. Yeah, he's amazing things.
He's already overcome our sin. We just have to recognize that and surrender to that.
And walk in the forgiveness that he's given us. Mm-hmm. Because that's really important, too. I struggle with
every
that.
Day.
Yeah.
So, Bill, you want to read our last sponsors here?
Well, we want to throw out a big shout-out to Just Garage Doors, now hiring, located at 2555 North Kiowa Boulevard, Suite 100. You can get a hold of them by the phone at 928-855-6331. Sunshine RV, experience sales and service at its best with Kyle and the gang. They're located at 2995 Maricopa Avenue, and they have a Northside location on Highway 95 next to Dillard's at the shops. You can also get a hold of them on the web at sunshinerv.com and by the phone at 928-855-6648. ServPro of Lake Havasu City, Bullhead City, and Kingman, their family owned and operated residential and commercial restoration and cleaning services. They're located at 2775 Kiowa Boulevard North. Get a hold of them by the phone at 928-855-9124. Also on the web at ServPro, Lake Havasu City, Bullhead City, Kingman.com. And Ace Pest Control, serving the Lake Havasu City area for over 20 years with termite pest and weed control. Get a hold of them by the phone at 928-680-0988 and on the web at acepestcontrolaz.com.
So before I forget, I want to give a big shout out to Bullhead City CR. Yeah. Whoop, whoop. You guys are so great. I'm hoping you guys are listening. It was a great night last night. We were just continuing to grow. I love you guys. Thank you for being a part of my family. Mm. I know everyone here in Lake Havasu City loves you guys too. Pray for you all the time and just pray that you continue to do what you're doing and allowing us to move forward. So Val, do you want to close us out?
I would love to.
Prayer.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for the freedom that is found only in you. You've set us free. Your word tells us that those who you set free are free indeed. We thank you for being with us always. You are as close as our next breath. You are always helping us and guiding us. We give you all the glory, honor, and praise. And in Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
So, for as true as it is, and as many times as Mike says it and beats it into my head, we are better together. I pray that you guys just continue to listen to us, to come back next week, to call in if you have any prayer requests, meet us online, any praise reports, anything like that. You guys, we just want to hear from you. Mm-hmm. We love you guys so much. We just thank you for listening to us on a regular basis, and we just pray that you come back next week.
Yes.
Thanks, you guys.
Goodbye for now from Recovery Radio, where we have hope for you.
Thank God redeemed.